hi, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Faith Greater Than Fear. It's when we have an opportunity to talk to followers of Jesus who are in love with him and are on a journey with him in many, many exciting and different ways. Some of them are students, some of them are family members, some of them are business people, some of them are in ministry. And today we've got a great treat, and a good friend of mine, Roy Morand, is with us. Roy, welcome.
Well, thank you, Mike. It's great to be here.
Great. So we're here in Joplin. Tell our audience where you're located and a little bit about your family.
I'm on the northeast side of Kansas City. I reside in a little city called Liberty. And I've got my wife and I have 4 children and 9 grandchildren. They all live within 20 minutes of us.
I am envious of you. We have them spread all over, and at one point they were international. So having them close is a real blessing. And as one person said, if we'd have had those grandkids earlier, we'd have known we wanted them first, right?
Definitely.
Well, tell us a little bit of your heart, number one, of how you're doing, your family, and the situation up there in Liberty near Kansas City. It's been a bit of a lockdown situation there. How COVID has affected you, your family, the neighborhood, and then we'll go on into the ministry side of things.
Well, we did shut down, you know, in March, like many people did. Shoal Creek stopped meeting publicly on Sundays, and we, you know, everyone went inside and began to figure that out. We reinvented ourselves on Zoom, and now, you know, exist, and a lot of people have found the wonders of Zoom connecting. And so our local fellowship has probably had about 6 people who've been infected with COVID. We started regathering about 4 weeks ago and trying to create a COVID resistant community, masks and social distance and all that kind of thing. And we've done well. We haven't had we're 25% of the people who were coming before are back gathering with us. But we had started a process of decentralizing even before COVID hit, and really realize that our attractional strategy may reach 25%, maybe 30% of the people in our community, but there are another 70% that may never, ever come. And we still feel responsible for taking the gospel to them. So we had started a process of building a micro church network of communities across our region and footprint. And so COVID kind of gave us some motivation to get that done, and helped us cast some vision to make it happen.
So that is exactly into the next part of the story that I want to talk about. Talk about Shoal Creek community and what it originally was, and then how it became a bit of a hybrid, and then to your point, how COVID maybe accelerated into the micro church small group communities that you're doing and utilizing right now.
Well, we came out of Willow Creek. We were a classic seeker church in that mode. Our Sunday morning service was all about reaching the lost. We still, even to this day, don't do any musical worship on Sunday morning. So we've grown basically through, you know, reaching lost people. But we realized after about 10 years and watching the growth that we were experiencing that we were going to grow out of our campus, have to buy land, build a new building, and we just didn't want to get into sinking that many resources into those kinds of assets. And so we began to look for something. At that point, our terminology was, is there any scalable model of gospeling that exists? We looked around the U.S. and we saw a lot of things, but didn't find anything. But we found overseas some folks that began to take us under their wings and help us understand what this multiplicative disciple making, where disciples make disciples make disciples. And you begin to see these small enclaves of biblically functioning communities just develop, which ultimately are an expression of ecclesia, you know, the church that Jesus said he would build himself. So we began to practice that and or pursue that, I guess. And as we did, we needed a framework to figure out who we were and how do we help people understand that. And that's where the hybrid car analogy became a real a picture for us, that we had this Sunday morning thing, still attractional, people still come. We still see people come to faith and baptize them, and that, you know, that works like it. We always thought it would, but there's this other side, and so we began to call it the come and go side, the electric engine and the gas engine of the hybrid car, and help people understand that both of those were built as strategies to fulfill the Great Commission. We express the Great Commission at Shoal Creek in making Jesus accessible. That's our call or the ministry that he's given us, is to make Jesus accessible, to help people, you know, change their relationship. We discovered early on, we used to say, you know, people, we thought, would you like to have a relationship with God? And many, many seekers responded to us, well, I have a relationship with God. And the next response was, well, no, you don't, you know, and that doesn't start off too well in terms of spiritual conversations. So we realized that actually people did feel like they had a relationship with God. And so our role was to help them change or elevate their relationship with God from a creator-creature relationship to a father-child relationship, and to build some intimacy in that relationship and understand what their father had done for them to make that relationship possible. So as we began this process, we realized that we're doing the same thing on both sides. One was a bit more programmatic and fixed in the week schedule on Sunday. Another was just planting these small groups that existed in a community. And there were groups that were for lost people. And we invited our friends, neighbors, and relatives to the table and asked them to read the Bible with us and discover what God had to say about life. And lo and behold, we realized that people did want to know more about the Bible, and they were eager, and they were just afraid of us cramming something down their throat, telling them what to believe, those kinds of things. And when we created these safe spaces for them, people would come and they would get their fingerprints on the Bible and discover that, you know, God does want to be their father. And it took shape over a longer period of time. It wasn't like an altar call or prayer or those kinds of things. It was a much more gradual experience as people began to understand who God was and that he wanted to be their father. And they began to embrace all the truths of the Bible, the cross, the fact that they're a sinner and need Jesus to live in this world and the world to come, you know, in relationship with God. And so we just, COVID provided an opportunity as we realized that, we have a 1,200 seat auditorium, 435 parking spaces, and we feel like we serve an area of about 300,000 people. They're not all coming on Sunday morning. And we couldn't offer enough services in a week to get them all there. And so we realized that if we were going to be responsible for their eternity, and we use this concept we call a circle of accountability, and we draw a circle on a map, and we say, look, I want to be responsible for the lostness in that circle. And I, before God, I just want to say, I want to make it hard for those people to go to hell. And so as we drew our big circle, we realized that we needed to have a different strategy. And those folks we found overseas, the city team guys are now known as New Generations, just took us under their wings and mentored and loved on us and coached us and held our hands through all kinds of struggling and figuring out what this looked like theologically and everything else. And they helped us kind of get this picture. So now as COVID comes, we're moving already toward building this micro church network in our area, and COVID hits and just people just come out of the woodwork saying, how did you know? How did you know? You know, in the reality that a little virus, a little microscopic thing that we can't even see with our own eyes could literally break the strategy that we practiced for well over 400 years. and put us into turmoil, trying to figure out how to make it happen. So that's kind of where we've been and what we've been up to, trying to figure out what it looks like now in establishing, you know, these microchurch networks across our area.
That's awesome. Several things. One, as a former missionary, one of the things I learned very well is that you have to go where you're wanting to be a missionary. You have to get and go to their pond, their environment. You have to drink in their culture. You have to learn their language. You have to love their worldview and start there and then move toward God. That's what you're doing and saying, we're not trying to be attractional and say, hey, you want to know Jesus? Come to America. But we, and as Americans, sent out missionaries, so you were missional. Number two is, Roy, is the thing that we say, oh, you know, COVID came and church was stopped and closed. The church was never closed, right? A building may have been closed and barricaded, but a church was never stopped. It's unstoppable. And you're showing that as you get into the communities. Tell us, therefore, what are the kinds of life-on-life things the microchurch, the community, the body of Christ in these communities are finding as ways to build relationship and to get into the fiber of their neighborhoods and communities?
Well, right off the bat, we helped our folks realize that the neighborhoods they live in really weren't neighborhoods at all. That when you kind of ask people if they know their neighbors' names, the reality is that in where I live, you know, kind of an upper middle class scenario, those people don't tend to have enough time in their lives to invest in neighbors. And so as COVID hit, trapped everybody in a home, we had people go door to door with a letter that just said, hey, I'm your neighbor. I'm here. I know it's a difficult time. I just wanted to tell you who I was and give you my contact information. If you need anything, you know, I'm praying. We haven't put a Bible verse in there to identify themselves as a spiritual person. I'm praying and trusting in God's protection, you know, through this. And I would like to draw us together. So we'd have them, you know, do things like announce a neighborhood Zoom meeting or announce a neighborhood app. We use this thing called band.us. It's a little white label app. And so the neighborhood would create their own instance of Band and now begin to communicate back and forth with one another. They had their phone numbers and stuff. And then as COVID began to let up, you know, a little bit, and we began to be able to come back together, people began to have neighborhood gatherings on driveways, just getting together. Some of them, you know, with a fire pit, some of them just, you know, come out in the evening. Some people would have, you know, regular times at 5 p.m, happy hour type times where they would Zoom together and just make connections with one another. And then just the network that developed of, you know, so-and-so needs this and so-and-so needs this and, you know, keeping track of who were the people that were most vulnerable in their neighborhood, creating the social safety net at a micro level, you know, at a neighborhood level, not a government run agency or anything, but just people helping people and loving on and helping each other out.
So the micro churches are learning their neighborhoods. They're being life on life representatives of Christ. You know, we find out, Roy, that when you concentrate us in the attractional model, we get a lot of us Christians, you put us all together, we kind of stink. There's a lot of brokenness. And then to that pre-follower of Jesus, they smell that stink and they call it hypocrisy. And they go, we don't want anything to do with it. And unfortunately, our concentration covers the aroma of Christ, which is so marvelous, so beautiful. And as you said, their creature and creator relationship moving to a father-child relationship can be exposed only once when they get to taste him. There are a lot of people who want to know about Jesus. A lot of people turned off by the organized church.
Oh, yeah.
So exactly. In this COVID situation, what are you finding out as the new normal for us as our American culture, this little virus tore us apart? What are you predicting, oh, great, wise, prophetic one, is going to be in our futures when it comes to Christian work in America?
Well, we were already headed down a road where loneliness was becoming one of our greatest health issues. The loneliness that the things it generates in terms of biological issues was already, you know, like our former Surgeon General, Vivek Murthy, just wrote a book called Loneliness. And so we're seeing a lot of mental health issues begin to arise. Talking to a convenience store manager of one of the larger conveniences store in Kansas City the other day, and he had just gone through his quarterly interviews with all 54 employees. And he was just telling me, these are young kids, you know, all probably under the age of 25. And he was telling me how difficult it was for them in life at this point, not so much financially or anything, but just feeling this sense of being alone and vulnerable, and, you know, having trouble coming to work, not because they're lazy or not because they're, you know, the classic millennial stuff that people like to talk about, but just this whole COVID arena was like an exponential factor in their lives of creating this mental health issue. So I think as the future rolls out, you know, that's going to be a huge issue. It was already an issue before COVID got here, but when we shut down and went into our own homes, it became a factor of two or three or four that we're going to have to deal with. And I do think, you know, the fact that you and I are talking on a screen here, that keeps us safe. But the idea that you and I were face to face, in the back of both of our minds, is the threat that we are to one another. You could have been near someone. I don't control who you're around. You don't control who I'm around. And so there's going to be a sense of skepticism, I think, that we carry forward for a few years at least in terms of how we actually work with one another face to face, and a sense of doubt. And so until we start gathering in large groups and don't see a virus, you know, spreading, we're gonna have a very insecure world that we live in.
And therefore, those of us as followers of Christ who own a faith that's real and personal need to express it intentionally for those who have fear, and that fear living itself out in loneliness, skepticism, doubt, hopelessness, all of the things that our Jesus can very much address and dissipate. You have written a book. I don't know, maybe you've written another one since we last talked.
Spent
Matches. Talk to us a little about it. Give yourself a good, good solicited plug, my brother, and what it contains. And in the minutes we have left here, what would you give as advice to our listeners in the journey you're learning through the book and through your life?
Well, you know, Spent Matches is just my story of moving into this idea of what I term multiplicative disciple making, where disciples make disciples make disciples. I saw a lot of discipleship in my life. From the moment I came to faith, I knew that that was a deal. I poured into people's lives, but I only had one generation of disciples. My disciples could never really make disciples. And it was because I leaned on my personality, my temperament, my gifts, my passions, my education. I never really thought that the methodology actually could help create the sustainability of multiplication. And so that's what Spent Matches is about, is my story of discovering that and then implementing it in a local church. We had an effective attractional church. It wasn't winning any awards. I wasn't on any lists of being the fastest growing church, you know, in America, but we were effective, regularly seeing people come to faith, baptizing them, and there was lots of new life around us. But we realized that there was a whole lot of people that we weren't affecting, and we were never going to get to them if we didn't ask the question, what would it take to reach, you know, our 300,000 that we had continually prayed for? So that's kind of what, you know, Spent Matches is about, and my journey into that. And it just we're continuing on that process today.
As a farmer, I understand two things very clearly. The farming, you get clarity of, if you want to harvest, you've got to take seeds and sow them, or you're a fool. for expecting a harvest. And if you're a livestock husbandry gentleman, like my father and I myself am as well, if you have animals that do not replicate, you either put them in a truck and sell them or you eat them. And so God desires harvest and he desires multiplication. And it's one of the elements of life. I love one of my Chinese brothers that said that, oh, my brother, we do not think there are as many Christians as you count as Americans in my country, because we only count one as a follower of Jesus who has multiplied another disciple who can multiply and reproduce. Yeah. And that is biologically one of the definitions of life. So in our closing minutes here, talk us about how you've learned from being a pastor of a church, an attractional model, traveled around the world, wrote your biography and discovery here and spent matches. What is it that we've got to do in that simple steps of saying, Jesus told us not to build a church, but to go and make disciples who can make disciples? How do we do it? What should we do?
I think there's a couple of keys or clues to this. One is asking the question, will it multiply? And so, you know, if I'm working with you and trying to get you into a multiplying lifestyle, I've got to ask myself, okay, if what I'm doing with Mike, could he do with someone else? And if he can't, then I need to change how I'm doing things. It's not the truth that we're attempting to get from one generation to the next. It's how we have supplied the truth to people. And so if I create a dependency in you and you have to ask me questions and that kind of stuff, and you're always dependent on the content that I know, then that's impossible. So it's really important to help people get their fingerprints on the Bible. They have got to have a face-to-face relationship with God and have an independent relationship with him. They can be interdependent, but they've got to be able to look God in the face on a regular basis and feel like they can hear from him. Second thing is they've got to learn to obey him. We've taught a generation or more of people to know him in a sense, to intellectually perceive God as a being and to toy with thoughts about who he is and his character. And we have, you know, carried those things deep, you know, into creating a whole vocabulary around them. And the reality is Jesus says, if you love me, you do what I say. Repeated throughout the scriptures is this idea of obedience, this idea of doing what I say. So, when people really have their first inclination to hear from God and do what he says, rather than just know what he says, we have created a generation of spiritually obese people. Yourself, that when you eat more than you calories than you can handle, things start to grow on you, and they're not good things. And then every time you go to the doctor, he talks to you about that and tells you that you need to stop that. Well, we have these spiritually obese people that know far more than they've ever done, and they use knowing to overcome some guilt, I think, maybe because of the doing. And so we just like to give people small amounts of truth and let them practice it. Go do it. Go figure out what God wants you to do in reality of that truth that you're hearing. And as they get into that habit of hearing and obeying, it's amazing. Things happen. So, the idea of creating no dependencies, will it multiply? And then creating it in an obedient, kind of obedient, accountable atmosphere really does make a huge difference.
Great words. And again, from my experience in learning another language, we all learned English without going to school. We were discipled, we imitated, learned a little to your point, and used it, obeyed, and then responded to what reactions we got. And that's how I learned my second language. And people went on and said, oh, you're so fluent, and you speak it at the same rate in the same way as an African. Well, I was discipled, and that's how I learned language. And the same way as we learn the language of followership of God and our Lord Jesus is, you're saying, learn a little, practice it, and come back and watch what God has done, do some adjustments, what didn't work, go out there and do it again. So, Roy Moran, thank you. You're a good brother. Blessings to you, your family, your four children in their marriages, and your nine grandchildren. And may you continue with all the Christian children there as well. Any final comment you want to offer before we say goodbye to our audience?
Well, I thank you, Mike. So good to be with you. Every time I'm with you, I'm reminded of the incredible wisdom that God has given you. So I appreciate the time and the work that you guys at GNPI do. It's, it's so creative. People wonder, where's Joplin, Missouri? And I think, well, there's this little light in Joplin, Missouri that's beaming the truth around the world. So I'm so appreciative for you guys, what you do and how you do it.
Thank you very much. So from Roy and myself, thank you for giving us about 20, 25 minutes of your time today. We hope it was a blessing. If it was, I'm sure there may be others in your network and your family who'd love to hear it. Share it on your social media channels as well. And we do have a podcast version of it also. So from Roy and myself, we say blessings to you until next time, when we hope your faith will still remain greater than your fear. God bless you.